Everybody knows John 3:16, but you need a second word and a second experience that's found in Luke 3:16. Let me read to you what the scripture says in Luke 3:16. John answered and saying to all, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Father, we've expected and experienced in the last several weeks, even several months, mercy drops of your presence here in this house. But for the showers, we plead. Grateful for the drops, but we need the showers. Lord, we need your presence. Thank you, Lord, for letting me live in the experience of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for what tens of thousands have experienced around this nation over the last several months, young people. Lord, remove our sinful pride. And Lord, do what you will, as we sung a moment ago, in all of our lives. Lord, help us to say yes to the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. It was 1989. It was in the spring of that year. I was serving as vice chairman and later chairman, but vice chairman of the North American Mission Board, managing nearly $100 million in mission giving of Southern Baptists around the nation. I had been pastor at Abba's House for 10 years, and we had more than doubled our church and had seen God do so many miracles and powerful things. But inside me, I knew there was something missing. I'd known that for a while. When I was saved as a child, I would hear God speak to my spirit. When I was a teenager, the Lord saved my life when I was 14, spoke to me powerfully. But when I got to college and seminary, I found out that he didn't do that anymore. That's what they said. We had our Bible and that was it. And underneath all of that, I was a good student. I got my earned bachelor's and master's and doctor's degrees from accredited schools. And grateful for all that. And the Lord anointed me to preach. If you've enjoyed my preaching, it's not because of me. It's because God anointed me to preach. The first time as a teenager I was asked to preach, I got sick and didn't go. That's the truth. And everything good that's ever happened through me and through Paulette and through our lives has been because of the presence of God. There's only one God on earth right now that's alive and well, and that's the Holy Spirit. That's the Holy Spirit. You say, wait a minute, I got Jesus in my heart. Jesus is the Holy Spirit. We serve a Trinity. Well, you need to explain that. Can't explain it. Can't express it, but I can experience it. And I had his mighty power. But in 1989, I was burned out. I was looked successful, but I was fed up. And some of that was because of church members. For most of my ministry here, 90% of the folks have just been great. The other 10%, I just don't want to talk about. And some of them were in leadership positions. And there's one thing I've noticed about church in this generation. We lack the stability and the faithfulness that was in the churches when I started. The largest church in Chattanooga 2 years ago no longer exists in this city. It wasn't us, but because of some mistakes and different things, I mean, it's gone. And someone said, well, would that ever happen at Central or Abba's house? I said, well, we've had our ups and downs. And like the rest of the churches in America, we've rode the COVID wave. And some folks never have come back. Some use it as a chance to slip off to another church. For whatever reason, I don't know. But I do know that for 72 years now, we've been here. Right here. Started in 1951, and this is one of the few churches, as old as we are, that has made the shifts necessary. A pastor in this town told a friend of mine just a few weeks ago, he said, you tell Pastor Ron to thank you. I want to thank him for breaking the racial lines in the city of Chattanooga. We did that in 1979 when I came here. I had a deacon who's no longer here, hadn't been here for a long time. He walked to me going out the door and said, I guess you're going to fill this church up. And he used the N-word. And being the nice fellow I wasn't baptized in the Spirit. I'm going to get back to that in a minute. I hadn't forgot where I was, by the way. Let me tell the truth. I said, don't let that door hit you in the backside on your way out. Because our dream for this church is becoming a reality. All the races, the cultures, people are coming here to be changed. And I said, Lord, why don't you fill every seat up? He said, I will sometimes. He said, but you need to know that people are going to come through here. And through the years of ministry here, tens of thousands have come through this building. Over 5,000 have been baptized. Many of them live in other states, other countries, other places. Thousands of pastors have come through our conferences here and absolutely seen their churches transformed. I won't call the church and pastor's name, but one pastor, they never had any small groups. You know, as far as I'm concerned, call them Sunday school classes. I don't care what you call them. But you need to be in a small group. We've been good at that through the years. Their denomination hardly had any group, so he started a groups ministry because of Abba's house. And since then, he now has written the material for the entire denomination to follow. I want to tell you something, folks. I love the church. Somebody said, well, are you a Baptist? Well, the church is a Baptist church still. I don't know how much longer. Ain't they thrown y'all out yet? No. Somebody said, are you a Baptist? I said, well, I was Baptist born and Baptist bred. When I die, I guess I'll be Baptist dead. But I'm not a Baptist because Baptists have always been right. I'm a Baptist because every church is locally autonomous. No denomination runs this church, never has. We've been affiliated by volunteerism with Baptist work and other groups. It's our choice to do that. But what I think I really loved is what happened to me in 1989. I had gotten to the place where I knew this wasn't where I started. Our church at that point was probably the largest church in Hamilton County, the fifth largest church in Tennessee, and only a couple of churches in Memphis and Nashville were larger. And we were booming. We were in the old building doing 2 and 3 services on Sunday morning and another on Sunday night. But there was something inside me that was hungry for more. I didn't know what to call it. I've learned since then. My grandson Trey went up to Asbury, left his school and went up to Asbury for several days. And it touched his life. And I said, "What was it, son?" He said, "Papa, it was the presence." Do you experience the presence of the living God in your life? Do you experience that presence to the degree and anointing that equips you to do the work that He wants you to do? One thing I've never been is a whiner, but I about got to that stage in 1989. I was fed up with trying to cajole people into do things they really weren't sure they wanted to do, and keep the church on, had to have 100 baptisms, had to have another 100 by transfer, had to grow, had to do this, had to do that, had to raise this money, had to do that, all that pressure. And there were causes in my heart, nothing immoral, but just causes in my heart that just didn't ring right. And I actually wrote my resignation out on a weekend after services, on Sunday. Good services if you're not hungry for the presence of God all over everything. See, you have church and then you have church. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And so I was vice chairman of the Home Mission Board. I was invited that week to speak at Glorieta, New Mexico, which was a campground that owned by the denomination. Now we sold it, but it was there. I was asked to close the conference. And I went out there, and I'd already decided to resign the next Sunday here. And had another job offer, not in the ministry, but I could go somewhere else, do something else. And I was just going to go to church and see if I could find what was missing in my life. And so I got up there, and on the night I got there, Minette Drumright spoke. Mrs. Drumright had been the wife of the executive of the Ohio Baptist Convention. He'd also been, at one time, the same man had been dean of Southwestern Seminary. And she was talking about his untimely death and how he had died in her arms in the back of an ambulance. And how she felt like she was falling, but she said, "Oh, I fell into the sweet arms of the Holy Spirit." Now, I'm listening to this on the back row, because back then I didn't believe in women preachers either. You got to know, something about to happen to me. She mentioned that she and her husband had attended a seminar led by a retired pastor and had a wonderful experience with the Holy Spirit, which she didn't detail for us. Later she would come here and by my wife's invitation and share her experience here at Abba's house, not in this building but in the other building. I got back to my hotel room and I just began to cry. Now, you may not happen. You say, "Well, I don't believe I can have that kind of dramatic experience." Well, you got to be hard and mean like I was. People say, "Well, how come you had a dramatic experience?" Because I had been taught that these things had ceased. The gifts had ceased. When you were saved, you got the Holy Spirit. That was it. That's what had been drummed into us. It's what had been pushed into our spirit. And here I was, an educated Baptist preacher, and I was tore up, crying on that bed, asking God to help me. I fell asleep. About midnight, my sleep was disturbed by a knock at the door. I went to the door, nobody was there. Wasn't anybody else staying on that wing of that building but me. I looked up and down the hall, nobody there. I went back to bed, laid back down, fell into a slumber. Door knocked again. I got up, opened the door. Nobody was there. Looked up down the hall, nobody was there. Went back to bed. fell asleep, heard the knock the third time. You say, was it a literal knock? Well, it was louder than that, I can tell you that. Somebody said, you hear the voice of God? Yes, I have, in my spirit man. I don't know if that was a literal door knock or what it was, but I do know it was loud. And I opened the door, and the Lord said, I'm here, I want to talk to you. Well, no, that you don't do that anymore. I got a Bible. Do you understand that until the last 100 to 150 years, nobody had a Bible? Nobody. Do you know during the first 400 years of the church's existence, there was not a completed 66 books, Bible, in anybody's hand, except maybe a few of the leaders of the early church? How'd they get along? The presence of God and the verbal witness and testimony of people who God had touched. The Lord looked at me and said, okay, get your Bible and open to Psalm 91. It was the 19th day of the month, so I was supposed to read legalistically. I read the Bible, Psalm 91 to 95 anyway. That day, if you do five psalms a day, you read through the whole book in a month. So I opened Psalm 91. It said, he that dwelt the secret place of the Most High. Well, where's that? I thought. And I discovered that there was a world beyond our three dimensions. Oh, I believed that in my head, but I had not experienced that in my daily walk. My body couldn't go, but my spirit could go into the presence of God, into the heavenlies. The powerful movement on my life and on my spirit. I kept reading. I got to Psalm 92:10, and that verse says, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I got to Psalm 92:10. It said, I shall be anointed with fresh oil. You wonder where fresh oil ministries came from? That's where it came from. Yeah. Psalm 92. And that's as far as I got. Heaven opened over me, and what was on the inside of me, the Holy Spirit exploded on the outside of me. And I had an experience with God in that room. When I came to myself, I had broken the bed. Now, it was a cheap bed, but, you know, one of those wires you stretch across a cot with a mattress about that thick on it. And that baby was all the way to the floor. I had my hands lifted up. Now, we didn't do that much. In fact, if you felt like it, you might get it up this high. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Felt like I had a garbage can lid on it, but I got it all the way up, you know. And strange sounds were flowing out of me. I learned about a month later it was speaking in tongues, which had already ceased, I'd been told. It was that there are two kinds of tongues in the Bible. Mysterious tongues. One is the prayer language, which God gave me, and there is a prophetic tongue that can be uttered and translated to the church. What happened to me at this moment was the experience of the prayer language of speaking in tongues. I felt like something was flowing out of me. You say, well, what happened, Brother Ron? I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. I've never been the same since that day. Ever been the same. I got back here and we had Phil Driscoll. Now this was before all of Phil's life and drama. You know, he's serving the Lord faithfully now. But Phil went through so much. False arrest with the government, all kind of stuff. But Phil had just come here from California out of the entertainment world and was just beginning to serve the Lord. And he was doing a concert in our church, the old building, that night. I'm sitting in my office. He walks in, looks at me, and says, "My God, you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost." He said, I got a word for you. He said, don't get up and make a big deal out of it. He said, you take that Bible just like you've been taking it. When you get to verses, you just preach the word. And I'm going to tell you, that's what I did for years, several years. And every week after week after week, another family, another person would come and say, "Oh, Brother Ron, I was baptized in the Holy Spirit." It was happening in our altar. One night, two young women, one of whom still a member of this church, the other is living out of state now, but served here as well. Parents are still here. They were out on the floor and had been worshiping in the spirit and in the understanding. God had touched them so powerfully. Much like what you've heard about Asbury. Happened right here. Folks, from about 1991 or 92 till the century changed, we had continuous awakening going on in this house. And I had people getting happy and I had hall committees getting mad. But God's Spirit had touched. Let me give you a simple illustration of what the baptism of the Holy Spirit is. When you're saved, you are indwelt by the Holy Spirit. He lives in you. When you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, you live in Him. What's on the inside is now on the outside. When you get saved, it's like taking a drink of water. When you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, it's like jumping in the ocean. You see the difference? Yes, it's real. You did receive the Holy Spirit when you were saved. Absolutely. But He wants to baptize you in His power. And that's not a one-time event. And it's not just speaking in tongues. That's been the problem with the movement across the years. Isn't it the initial evidence of the Holy Spirit? If you think so, that's fine. I wish you'd show me one verse that said that. See, my problem is I got that much Baptist in me, I still believe the Bible governs everything that we do. And I do believe it's an evidence and an early evidence. But I wouldn't go so far as to say, if it don't happen right now, the Holy Spirit didn't touch your life. That just isn't true. I had been touched by the Holy Spirit. I'd been divinely called. I had felt the Holy Spirit move in my life. But there had never been an absolute takeover, folks, if you know what I mean. You remember Ezekiel? God tells him to step into the water. And it's ankle deep. He's fine. I'm okay right here. I'm doing what the Lord wants me to do. Then it got knee deep. Oh, yes. Woo, woo. You read Ezekiel, then it was a river to swim in. What had happened? He was no longer in control. The Holy Spirit had taken control of his life. And I want to tell you, once that happens, all this whining and pouting and pitiful spirit and it's not fair and, you know, and I'll do what I please, all that goes. And you learn like the late Jack Taylor used to sing, "I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes." The baptism of the Holy Spirit. Three things. One, it's a second work. Absolutely. The Bible teaches that in the 8th chapter of Acts. You read about that bunch at Samaria. It says in Acts chapter 8, verse 14, and when the apostles who were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them, who then they, when they had come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. Now watch this, for as yet he had not fallen upon them, none of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid hands on them and they received the Holy Spirit. See, you some things you don't have just because you're ignorant of them. Same thing in the church at Ephesus. When you read in Acts chapter 19, verse 1, it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus, and finding some disciples, he said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" But they said to him, "We have not so much as heard whether there's a Holy Spirit." Now, can I tell you, they were followers of John, so this verse isn't translated right. Can I tell you how it could be translated? "We have not so much as heard the Holy Spirit as I am." That's how the early church fathers translated it in Latin from Greek. We're not sure the Holy, we didn't know the Holy Spirit was God. Well, that makes sense to me, because what did John preach? What I read to you when I started. He will baptize you in the Holy Spirit and fire. They'd heard of the Holy Spirit. They just didn't know who he was. They didn't know he was one with Jesus and one with the Father. And so you go on in Acts 19. And when they heard this, he told them they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. So it's okay to get water baptized a second time. Happened right here. And when Paul laid hands on them, the Holy Ghost came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. Two gifts of the Spirit were released. I wish the gifts were operating. Well, they don't operate unless you're baptized in the Holy Spirit. I got a gift. Did you open it? You've got them. I wish I could speak in tongues. You can. I don't even have time. I wrote a whole book on that too. I don't have those out here, but I've got them on speaking in tongues. See, the difference between speaking in English, I think of the word, then I say it. Speaking in tongues, you say it and then hear it. I don't know if I could do that. That's the problem. You got to let that gift flow. And then you hear it, and if God wants you to know what it means, he tells you, "Well, I thought like every tongue had to be interpreted." No. Sometimes they in Acts 19, they spoke in tongues and magnified God. Nobody interpreted it for them. Doll, don't shout me down now. I can feel the presence of God right now. And it's not just me. But somebody hearing me in this room or on the video or on the transmission is going to be baptized in the Holy Spirit today. It's going to happen. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. I like the two. And with fire. Passion. Excitement. Burning. I lack that today in so many worship services where we gather. There may be excellent entertainment, but where's the fire? There may be magnificent oratory. Where's the fire? Some of the greatest services I've ever been in have been led by people you've never heard of, because they caught fire. I don't know what we're going to do about this ministry or that ministry. Let the fire fall. That's one. Number two, the baptism of the Holy Spirit is the seal of God. You read in Ephesians chapter 1:13, in Jesus you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Now in English, when we think of seal, we think of sealing a can or a jar. That's not what this word means. This word means to be marked. When Paulette and I were over in Athens, Greece, we were buying some souvenirs, and you could buy replicas of some real artifacts, that bowls and things that were found from the time of Paul and of the New Testament. And they were exact copies, and the way you knew they weren't some street fake was they had a silver mark upon them, around them, that was placed in a certain way. And that verified that they were genuine in their makeup and in the way they looked. And I asked more, and I found out the word in our Greek New Testament has nothing to do with sealing something up like a vacuum. It means an outward, visible mark. To be baptized by the Holy Spirit means that which is on the inside of you has now marked you on the outside. Water baptism is a picture of death going under the water and resurrection coming out of the water. If you were joined the Orthodox Church, and I believe this is still true, there are many groups of them, just like there are many groups of Pentecostals and Baptists and Methodists and everything else. You know, but if you join them, they put you in the water, baptize you by immersion. When you come up, they poured oil on you. You know what they call that to this day? The charism. We get our word charismatic from it. Our word grace comes from it. Our word gift comes from it. The word charismatic is an English corruption of the Greek charism, which represented the anointing of oil, which was a sign of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. You were baptized, and coming up out of the water, just like Jesus, that anointing oil represented that dove. Do you understand that Jesus, he baptized, he comes out of the water, and the Holy Ghost falls on him? I guess it's okay then, isn't it? Let the hall committees know it's okay. Happened to him. You know, I think if Jesus showed up now, we'd be embarrassed. I can imagine Jesus walks in here, knows some people have been sealed and marked by the Holy Spirit's power. He looks around, instead of plastic plant, he finds a real plant, planted in real dirt. He knows there's some people here that need to be healed, maybe of blindness. So he clears his throat and fetches a big harker. If you don't know what a harker is, that's a wad of spit. He flings it with his tongue into the dirt. Takes his hand and makes a mud pie. Holds that muddy hand up and says, somebody here want to be healed today. People will flee for the door. They got a nut over there at Abba's house today. But isn't that what he did? Now, he didn't do it every time. You know, the problem with Pentecostals is we'd want to start the mud and spit church. What's interesting about it is it wasn't in the program. And even when I'm saying this, I know that a few of you are disturbed that I might leave the program. I pray God that we'll leave the program and that His Spirit will move in power. Number three, not only is it a second work, that's first, not only is it a seal, a mark of authenticity on our lives, that seal of God opens heaven over us. Listen to what Ephesians tells us about the seal. Verse 13, Ephesians 1 says, "You're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise." Listen to verse 14. You want a definition of the Holy Spirit baptism? Here it is. "Which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession under the praise of His glory." The word earnest can be translated down payment. It can be translated guarantee. He says when you are baptized in the Holy Spirit, you get a down payment of what you're going to get a full payment of when you get to glory. I don't know why the gifts operate all the time, and sometimes it doesn't seem like they're operating in as much power, but I do know this. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is a foretaste. How many sick people in heaven? That's why some people get healed. Why don't everybody get healed? Well, I got a book on that too. Don't have it with me, but I got a book on the healing of the healing gifts of the Holy Spirit. The reason you're not all going to always be healed because you're still living in a dead body. You're going to get a new body, then you'll have ultimate healing. Amen? Glory to God. How many sad people in heaven? The joy of the Lord is our strength. You ever been going through something horrible and all of a sudden laughter burst out of you? Guess who did that? Your partner, your governor, your savior. I got Jesus. Don't know if I got the Holy Spirit. You got Him, you got the Holy Spirit. He may not have baptized you yet, but the baptism of the Spirit opens heaven. In those moments, the breach between this dimension and the other dimension is broken. Your prayers are clearer. Your faith becomes more assured. And your heart becomes more blessed and anointed by the power of the Holy Spirit. It opens heaven. It's the earnest money of our inheritance. If you had any idea what was coming, you'd quietly wait and ask God to baptize you in His Holy Spirit. 1 Peter 1:3 says that we've been saved to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that fades not away, reserved in heaven for you. The Bible also says for all the promises of God, that's all the promises, 6,000 of them in the Bible, for all the promises of God in Him are yea, and in Him amen, unto the glory of God. Now He which establishes us with you in Christ and hath anointed us, somebody say anointed, is God, who has sealed us and given the earnest, the down payment, the guarantee of the Spirit in our hearts. Are you baptized in the Holy Spirit? This is the morning, the opportunity. So here's what we're going to do right now. One, if you're not saved, you have to do that first. And so you need to bow your head with me and just say, "Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Come into my life and save me." If that's what you're sensing in your heart you need to do today, when we stand up in a moment, walk straight over to that table and tell them, I prayed to give my life to Jesus. That'd be the quickest way. You can stop by one of the pastors. But they're going to be doing some other things too. I sure would like to be a member of Abba's house. Walk right over to that table. If you're already saved and baptized, tell them what you want to do. If you haven't been baptized, tell them you want to schedule it. They'll sign you up. But my purpose in this message today is what Trey Phillips, Ronnie M. III, told me after his visit to Asbury. It was the presence, Pop. It was the presence. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to have you come forward if you're hungry in your heart for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We'll have some of our pastors here. And I'm going to do a prayer for everyone that's here. They're going to have anointing oil if it's needed. They're going to be able to lay hands on you if you want that. Hey, by the way, none of that has to happen. You say, what if I come up there and it doesn't happen right away? It will when you get home. Can I give you some relief? It's okay to come forward. If it doesn't happen right this minute, give God a chance. Nothing has ever happened to me in my spiritual life first publicly. I was alone when I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. I was. I was alone when God called me to preach. My life journey has been done with lonely moments with God. Now later, they're declared openly, they're declared publicly. And he may do that for you. When I was preaching down in Puerto Rico, the leading Good Morning America host on their big network met me right after the service and said, I want to be saved. I led her to the Lord. And by then, you have to understand, you know, our Latin American friends that we have in our church, and they meet this afternoon at 3, you know, great, great spiritual folks. Well, they're curious too. They gathered around. She was crying. She got through. She said, now, there's something else, isn't there? This is the only time this has ever happened to me like this. I said, yes, there is. She said, you call it the fullness or baptism of the Holy Spirit. I said, yes, ma'am. She spoke English very well. Right there, she bowed her head. I led her in a prayer to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit fell on her. This proud, famous woman. And all the Puerto Ricans around me, not Puerto Ricans, Panama, I'm sorry, Panama, all the Panamanians around me, they begin to praise the Lord loud. And she began to speak. Well, not being a Spanish speaker, I thought maybe she was speaking Spanish. No, it wasn't Spanish. And all the Panamanians knew that. And revival broke out again in that meeting. I've seen it all. It doesn't have to happen the same way for everybody. What's the requirement, Brother Ron? There's just one. Hunger. How do you know hunger? Because somehow you just know you're not full. You just know this isn't all. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness. That's Jesus, by the way. They shall be filled. It is a fullness that overflows and marks you on the outside. Now I'm done talking. I want you to stand up on your feet, if you would, right where you are. Don't leave. For those of you who may not know, this isn't the benediction. We'll tell you when it's time to go. It's not time to go yet. If there's in within you, how many of you lift your hand right now and say, Brother Ron, I know that I have been baptized in the Holy Spirit and I have the gifts as evidence. Hold your hand up. Put your hand down. You could not lift your hand. That doesn't mean you ought to come down here. But if there's something in you that believes there's more, more not to be received, but to be released, I want to invite you to come. And I'm going to have the pastors come after you in a moment. But I'm going to invite you to come and stand right here in front of me while they're playing this music. This is your time. This is your moment. This is your opportunity to be filled and baptized in the Holy Spirit. I want to make your way down these aisles. Some of you from way in the back, you're the only reason you're here today is so you could hear this word. I want you to come and stand right over here in front of me. Now, I'm not going to trick you. Come right over here. Don't be afraid. Come right up here. Get out of your seat and make your way down here with me right now. I'm going to pray a prayer over all of you. Then our pastors are going to minister to you. And it's going to be the beginning of God's fresh work in your life, in the life of this church. Anyone else who's going to come join us up here for this prayer? Some of you are waiting for healing in your life. The gifts operate freely when we're baptized in the Holy Spirit. I'm going to ask you to get out of your seat. Make a decision right now that'll transform your life forever. This is your moment. Right now, if you sense a hunger in your heart that God wants to do something. I mean, for some of you, God's probably working on you pretty well. For some of you, you want to hit the door pretty quick. That may be the Holy Spirit and the devil resting over you, your spirit right now, because your potential filled with the Holy Spirit goes up 1,000%. Anyone else will come and join these before I pray over them. Come right on up, sir. Blessed are you that hunger. Come right on up. This is your moment. Anyone else? I sense God drawing others right now. Those of you watching online, join with us in this opportunity for ministry. This is your moment. Anyone else before we pray with these? All right, here's another little hook. While I'm praying with them, some of you are going to get caught on that hook right out there, and you're going to pray with me too. If you sense that happening in your life, make your way right down here with us and allow the Holy Spirit to do what only He can do in your life. Now, the pastors that Brother Kent has designated to help, I want you to make your way down here and stand behind these folks right now, if you would, and be ready to minister to them. The pastors that are on assignment to minister today, please come up and stand behind these that are here. All of you comfortable laying hands on people? Good. Because they're going to turn around in a moment and you're going to lay hands on some of them. I know all these pastors, and every one of them have been baptized in the Holy Spirit. Many of them have had tremendous experiences with the Lord Jesus. And what's going to happen to you is going to be like a disease, but it's going to be that way. It's going to be catching. Joy is going to begin to come out of you. And the anointing is going to break loose in you. When the Brownsville revival broke out, it was because two teenage girls got filled with the Holy Spirit. Two. And 7 years and over 100,000 souls later, God had done a mighty work. I believe you're here for that this morning. Everyone in here, please stretch your hands toward these folks right now. Lord, I feel your presence. Oh, blessed Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray right now. your gifting would begin to flow through me and through these others that are here and through this body called your church. Bring to memory, Lord, to everyone in this room that's baptized in your spirit already, that moment in your life when your presence overwhelmed them. Let them feel that renewal today. In fact, that's the first prayer. Lift your hand right now where you are and say, Lord, renew your spirit within me right now. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. Now, those of you in front of me, I'm going to pray over you, and I want you to repeat this prayer after me, okay, out loud. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I want to confess all my sins. Let your blood wash them away. Forgive me. Heal me. Drive out any infirm spirit. Let me be free to receive what you're going to do in my life. I believe. I put my faith in your promised word. Now say, Holy Spirit of God, I need you. I know you're on the inside of me. I need you to baptize me. My answer is yes, before you even ask. Oh, yes. Right now, come Holy Spirit, touch them. Say, I'm hungry. Fill me, Lord, with your anointing and with your mighty presence. I receive all the gifts you want me to have. I release the prayer language. I'm not afraid. May all the gifts be loosed in my life with your anointing and power. In Jesus' name. Now I want you to turn around right where you are. I want our pastors now to wade in with anointing oil or anointing, whatever you want to do it. As the Lord leads you, begin to lay hands on these that are here. I want you to stretch your hands this way and pray for them, please, in this building. Yeah, stretch your hand by lifting it up and pointing it this way. That's right. Receive. Now, right now, I'm praying over everyone in this room that others will make their way down here to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, would you just surround the doors as people even try to walk out? Lord, let the Holy Spirit stop them. Lord, I pray that you would move in glory and power on these that are here in Jesus' name. I pray your healing grace and mercy would flow out by the power of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' mighty name.